Secondary.
Secondary.
Starting front.
Starting front.
My name is Tanya Sturgill. I know 99% of you and have had the pleasure at one time or another assisting in working with your children. I'm the autism resource specialist for the elementary schools. This is my 13th year in this position.
You're good. Sorry.
Hello, I'm Amanda Dennis. I'm the director of special education. And this is my 5th year in Fayette County. My first year as the official director of special ed, I was the interim last year. So it's very nice to meet all of you, and we are glad to be here.
And I'm Diane Shuff at Ashcraft. I can ditto Tanya. I've seen many of our students go from preschool through exiting our schools, and so it's been a long privilege knowing some of our kids. It's been an awesome time. But I am an associate director for special education and help with the autism programming in our district.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for coming out. And I'm Melanie. And for your patience, beautiful patience, because she had reached out. We're supposed to do this last year doing my listening, learning, leading plan. And as you may or may not know, I was stricken with cancer, stage 4. And so after going through treatment and everything, the prayers go up, blessings come down. So, I'm here with you this evening. So finally, thank you again for your patience, partner. So a couple of things. One, about me, I'm your serving superintendent. What I hope to do this evening is to at least begin to establish a dialogue, right? The windshield is bigger than the rearview mirror, so I can't go back. I don't have the experiences that you have. But the windshield, as we look ahead, what can we do to make it better for all children, certainly our babies? And I say that as a parent with 3 children. I have one son who's gifted, another student or child who's just a hard worker. Just a hard worker. In fact, I got to leave here and go work with her, right? Mm-hmm. And then another child who has exceptionality, and he has Asperger's. And so, some things he's gonna keep in. But that's our range, if you will. And each child is special, each child is unique, and each child requires a different set of sort of strategies, love, fear, etc. And so what I hope to do is tell you a little bit more about who I am in terms of my core values, tell you about who we are as a district, sort of globally, who are our students, and then to get into what we're doing, a little bit of my entry plan, and then to go into specifically what we're doing to help better serve our students with across the autism spectrum. All right. So I like to begin with my core values. Students first. Why is that? Similar to what you shared, I mean, you took me right back to when my son was first diagnosed, and I'm sitting there in a district that I won't name, and a power differential where everyone, was white, and just me and my son in there, and here we go with a black male being labeled, right? So that was my thinking. Now, just being, one thing you know about me, I want to keep it real. Right. So you took me right back to that experience, and they automatically started talking about a deficit model of what he cannot do, couldn't do, compared to his peers. Right. And so, I just felt kind of awkward, and that really set a negative tone in terms of the relationship. And back then, last century is about family, our parents are our partners, but it really set a negative tone when you go in and they automatically talk about what your child cannot do. And so when you were talking, it kind of, and I couldn't homeschool, but I moved my child to a different district.
I know,
so it's, and I probably should have stayed and sort of advocated for better, because advocating for my child, it might be better for other children as well. But at any rate, that was circa last century. And
never
so
never say that in an IEP meeting.
But, I'll just try to keep it real. So students first for me, and second, victories in the classroom. You know, I got a daughter at Lafayette, and she's in the band, and you know, go Generals, and the pride of the Blue. I'm learning all that stuff, right? Pride of the Bluegrass. I may get it wrong, but you know, having success on the football field, volleyball, etc., for me, for students, is optional. Where success is not optional, and where it's a necessity and mandatory for all children, it's in the classroom. And that's the you know, the power of a great teacher. And all of you are here because you probably can think back in the recess of your mind that you had a great teacher, right? That touched you. We all know what that means. Behind that, leadership, capacity building, shared accountability, and collaboration for results are keys to success. And that's really important. It's about having a great leader in every school. It's about giving teachers time to come together and staff to plan, again, to meet the needs of each and every student. And then shared accountability. You know, I know we use accountability and some people think it's an ugly word, etc. But shared accountability, if you're not successful, why are we not successful? We're in this together, right? And what can we be doing to help each other, to better help our students? As I said, last century, it was parents are our partners, but the parent dynamics change. You heard as we went around the room in introductions, right? So it's families are our partners, because the child may not be living with his or her biological, so families are our partners. We want to make sure that we wrap our arms and partner with the family. And last but not least, it takes an entire community to ensure success of our schools. And you're a part of that community. I was at this State Accountability Steering Committee this all day today. I got to say this morning, but it went into the all day. And a non-educator who was there said something really profound. Said, you know, you can label a school and give a score and do the rankings, etc. He said, but what you're asking schools to do this century and in Fayette County 2016 is a lot different than you're asking of Fayette County Public Schools in 1980 or in 2000. And the educators know what I mean by that, and the parents do as well. And he said, you know, instead of just giving a score to the school, what about to the community? Because the community needs to get engaged. We need the community to do more. And so that's why it takes an entire community. It's that African proverb that says it takes a village, right? And so last year, when I started this work, it was about a listening, learning, leading plan. And coming into the district, there was pre-entry work, entry, developing my action plan, and then I presented that back on May 25th. And I want to kind of give you a high-level view of that plan, because what's in that plan had nothing to do with my preconceived conclusions prior to coming to Fayette County. It had everything to do with the town hall meetings, the surveys, the input and data from internal and external stakeholders. So I truly came in with a blank slate, other than loving UK basketball, choruses. I'm not going to say the other B word. But you know what you're famous for, right?
Yeah.
So steps in that process was to listen. And to listen deeply, actively listen. You know, not try to problem solve, but to hear from you, the experts, those who care deeply about the community, those who are most invested in the community. To learn, to share the information in a plan, and did I hear you correctly, right? Sort of a check-in with you. Present the plan, and now we're acting on that plan. So you said, okay, we're acting. Well, the plan started July 1, really to go into effect. So August, September, October, about 3 months into it. Okay, so, and we're hitting some bumps along the way, but the plan represents things that we're doing differently. We still don't what we've always done, because in education, we don't know how to stop. You know, we just don't know how to stop, but we're doing a lot of things differently as well. So what did the plan look like? There was quantitative, qualitative data collection. We did listening sessions, curriculum audits, first time ever, right? Because we're always trying to get smart. An audit of our career technical education program, first time ever, and that was done by the Kentucky Department of Education. We did an audit of our ELL program, of our gifted and talented program, right? and our special education program as well, right? And then a comprehensive look at central office in terms of how we're structured to better support our students. And so that led to, along with the input from you, to us moving towards some desired results and things that we hope to accomplish. And that was a high-functioning board superintendent team. So I really want to take time and say that you can't have a high-performing organization without a peak-performing board. And right now, we really have some fantastic board members. I guess you're kind of fortunate. I've been in places where they were less fortunate in terms of the board representation. But board members who get it and understand and want to make the right investments for children. A renewed sense of energy and optimism and engagement from students, families, employees, and the community, because we can't do it without our community. We need our broader stakeholder group to be with us. A comprehensive summary of findings based on that data, and then a plan to kind of move forward. Now, coming in to an organization, you always look for, you know, plans that were there that you can pick up on and say, okay, here's where you left off at, right? Here's what I need to do next, right? So you think about any sort of home improvement. You're kind of like working on, you know, adding addition to your house or whatever. That contractor has a plan. And if that contractor were to get sick or whatever, you got that plan, you can hire someone else, and they can pick right up and keep going. Well, we didn't have a plan. There was no plan. I looked around, searched high and low, the little desk drawers in my office and stuff. It's a nice desk, but there's nothing in there, right? There's no plan. And so to come, you know, and present the plan to the community, right? Is it perfect? Probably not, as I looked at it. But does it reflect our best thinking? Not my best thinking, but our best thinking? It does. And the plan is only good for a year. Only one fiscal year, right? Beyond that, we're working on a strategic plan for the district that would go out 4 and 5 years. And that would see over the horizon, right? So the plan was never intended to go beyond just a year. So with close to 13,000 stakeholders, this is your plan, right? And it's interesting because coming into community, there's a lot of distrust. We're going to take this survey, but is anyone going to? Yeah, right? And is it going to change? And I'm like, man, oh ye a little, right? Hey, but you know, but it was based on, again, the rear view mirror, right? And based on experience. And then you meet your community where you find it, right? And so I knew there was a high climate of distrust, and rightfully so, right? And even within the organization itself. And so what I want to do now, after kind of giving you a look back, if you will, is to show you sort of who are we. So if you could scroll over the bottom. So Fayette County, we're 100 students. Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
I'm just going to tell you.
Oh, you just scroll over the, what's my, did you scroll over?
You want to go the next slide?
No. Scroll to the bottom, you'll see the play button. Okay.
That's all right, partner. You're all right.
Thank you. So again, depending on your point in time, it determines sort of what we look like. But I wanted to kind of give you a really broad picture of what the system looks like, what our students look like in particular. And just ask you as you reflect, if some of you may not be seeing it from sort of that view, kind of done on a ratio of 100 students, right? And so any aha, anything you learned from watching that? Anything surprise you didn't know before?
Well, I would be curious to know as far as like, I naturally want to break it down elementary, middle, high, and especially like demographics for those reading proficiencies and math proficiencies, because it breaks my heart that we keep letting kids move on up that aren't ready to move on up.
That's right. Thank you. Any other sort of reflection?
Number of languages.
Huge.
I don't know, is it that big for a college town? Is it statistically unusual for
the demographics look like this?
Yeah. To have that many languages spoken.
I would say for a college town, the languages probably not, but I think if you look at just the county itself, what does the county look like? Does the county look like that? Does the county have 54% of families in its county in poverty? Does the county, right?
Right.
So I think that's what you got to look at.
How many kids are food dependent, you know, worried about where their next meal comes
yes.
from. So much more than just school.
Yes.
Is it significantly different?
I felt honestly like I used to work in 4-H, and so I went into a lot of schools, and I thought the free reduced lunch numbers, for me, seemed lower than what I would have expected. I would have expected more students on those, especially in the elementary schools. There are some elementary schools where it's 98% free reduced lunch.
Yes, right, and if you look at the county, right, I mean, just in our district, 47% students of color. Is the county 47% people of color? No, nowhere near that, right? You know, so that's the, you know, so depending on your context and where you interface with the school or when you last, you won't know that the demography has changed considerably, and that's why it really takes the community, because trying to meet the needs of each and every student, which is the goal, and we must do that. We can't step away from that. And this isn't to say, you know, excuse making. No, it's to let you know that we can't do this alone. We need our families. We need our community. We need organizations such as the Autism Society of Bluegrass. We can't do this alone. And so some of the emerging things that came out of the entry plan, all the data collected, was access, right? Class size, teacher caseloads, as one could imagine, communication engagement, that's communicating with our families. Partly why I'm here this evening, because we've got to do a better job at communication, right? Curriculum and instruction, equity, global competitiveness and rigor, guidance counseling, that actually came from students. Right? Right? I mean, they're okay. That came from students.
I'm a product of Fayette County Public Schools.
There you go.
Years and years, they
yeah. So that came directly from the students at student roundtables, because they also, you know, can give input. High quality teachers and school-based decision-making councils. And so all of that kind of was emerging themes. So what it led to were 8 pillars focused on effective governance and leadership, student success, and that's educational excellence and equity for all. And that's what we're striving towards, and that's what we can't rest. We got to make sure not only students have the opportunity, but the access. Right, and equity doesn't mean the same, right? To me, as I define it, it means to me that every child not only gets what he or she deserves, but gets what he or she needs, right? And so the needs, and I got 3 children, right? They all deserve a roof over their head, a little food in the refrigerator, okay? They deserve that, but their needs are different. Their needs are different, so I got to be differentiated to meet their needs, right? School management, improvement, innovation, great staff, because you can't do this without great staff. You got to invest in your staff. world-class operations, data research accountability, student family community engagement, strategic partnerships, and communication and external affairs. Out of those eight pillars, we have 100 strategies. And so now I'm going to kind of walk you through specifically the strategies that emerged as a result of the work in student success that deal with our autism services and supports. So if you, I didn't even bring a copy of the plan. Melanie, you got a copy of the plan? It's on the website. Okay, okay. But it's on the website, and you can see it. And one of the things that I think that sparked our conversation, continued dialogue, is that right in student success, it's broken out with gifted and talented, ELL, right, special education. And in there, it talks specifically about autism. I think that's where we had our conversation. And that's what we want to expound on this evening, is really, what does that mean? How did that kind of surface? Well, the issue around autism surfaced because of you. Not just you in the room, but certainly our families. They raised and said this was an issue through surveys, through focus groups, etc. That's why I didn't even know coming in that would, surface. Again, I came in with a blank slate. So here's a team, they already introduced themselves, and sort of a brief history I give you, and then I'll let you guys kind of take over some of the specifics. Now, so I'm looking in the rear view mirror, and though I wasn't here, so some of you can, fact check me or correct me, right? 2001, FCPS recognized a population of students with autism spectrum disorder. It was increasing. Okay, they created an autism resource specialist. Again, trying to change and keep up with, our student population, right? It was a response. 2009, autism assessment team, school psychologists provide additional time, 0.4 to assist and focus, increase in assessment skills among other staff, right? And then 2010, the response, partnered with KDE, the National Professional Development Center on Autism Spectrum Disorders, right? So they try to, again, trying to solve it, trying to be able to skill up to serve our students with the love and care and support that they need and that all students need. And then develop a model program implementing evidence-based practices. So we're going to come back to EBP over and over again. 2011, the first Autism Summer Conference. Some of you may have attended that conference, right? And again, still continue focus on evidence-based practices. What does the research say that you can better meet the needs of our students? 2012, the number of students identified across the autism spectrum disorder reached, 400? And they added a second autism resource specialist and a BCBA as a result. Again, trying to provide that support to better serve our students. 2013, autism resource guide was produced across all schools, again, as a tool to better communicate with families, etc. And then this shows you the trend line from 2010, 11, I think that is, all the way to 15, 16. Right. So you can see a through line. All right. Okay. So you can just see the trend. Now, remember also, so I want to kind of qualify this a little bit. In 2010, about these, you probably had maybe 37,000 students. Now you got up to 42,000. So the pie, the number of students, the denominator has grown too in terms of the number of students we serve. We have two elementary schools, new high school coming, etc. Right? But still within students with exceptionalities, some say students with disabilities. I always tell my son, you're exceptional. Me, the exception. So forgive me if I use that term, and that's just the term that I use. All right. And so 2013, Autism Support Center, they launched online support service and resources and links for teachers, therapists, administrators, parents, the like. All new special education teachers receive training on how to access this site, and then ongoing PD. And family support is really important. like I said, parents was last century. It's about families now, right? And so team provided different avenues to support parents over the years. Parent support has been individualized, and current efforts include supporting the efforts of the Autism Society of the Bluegrass. And so we're trying to do our best to kind of get these tools in the hands of our families who need them and to be there to support them. Is it perfect? No. Would it be perfect if we do it on our own? No. But together we can make it perfect. And so I told you that part of the entry plan was special education audit. That's the first time we had an audit of our special education program in the district and ever was last year. So I'm going to turn it over to who wants to go through the audits.
I'll take this one and then we'll move along. As a part of the special education audit, we prepared a whole lot of documents and access to, you know, what are our practices right now to the team. And so they had all of that on site when they came, but they had people dedicated on that team who spent time in schools doing walkthroughs in classrooms and hosting listening sessions with parents, with staff, with teachers, with district staff. So lots of different stakeholder groups participated in those listening sessions where they did interviews and were able to give input. And as a result of that, when the 100 strategies that are in the Blueprint for Success came about, there were two needs that were identified related specifically to autism: additional training and evidence-based practices, and then develop a plan to establish a parent support group for families of students with autism. So, and the pillar two, where all of our special education strategies fall within pillar two of that Blueprint for Success. And I'm going to let Tanya talk more about the evidence-based practices, and those all relate to strategy 17.
And we're just 3 months into this. Mm-hmm. Okay, just be mindful.
So what, I feel like I need to stand up. I'm used to standing up. I was extremely excited to see autism in the plan for the district. Like I said, I've worked with many of you and your wonderful children over the years. Most of them still remember me, can call me by name even. What we did was we conducted a survey for all of our teachers when we broke it down into four levels: preschool, elementary, middle, and high. And we listed all those evidence-based practices that we've been providing training for through the Summer Institute, through after-school trainings, and then through the online support, to ask them, what strategies do you feel like that you are able to implement with fidelity currently, and then where would you like to see more training? So we did that in conjunction with, we did an analysis of over 50 IEPs for students with autism to look at also, in fact, what evidence-based practices were teachers putting in their IEPs, what are they saying they're using. And so from that, then we have kind of analyzed that. We have analyzed that information and are moving forward with continuing to provide that support. Already what we've done is we've provided a preschool professional development for not just their teachers, but the paraprofessionals who work with our students. We had close to 90 participants that day. We covered evidence-based practices, visual supports, using time delay and airless learning in a preschool setting, and we talked a lot about communication, functional communication, and language development. We already talked about the survey and analysis. Through just our special education department, we have monthly professional learning networks. And so through those, we have already provided, all special education teachers in Fayette County have received, and again, every year we remind them about the Autism Support Center that is just so valuable in terms of what it can provide for our teachers. So we always take them back through that to look through those resources. We have already trained about 50 of our elementary teachers in what does ABA and what that looks like in this school setting and how we use the principles of ABA throughout the school day. And then we're also, we have our first two training sessions that are offered more district-wide outside of those monthly things that we do. Are coming up in October, and then we have the Professional Learning Center at Lindley opening, so we're going to be providing our trainings over there November through through March. Mm-hmm. Is this, y'all let you do that? When we looked at our survey results, across, we've had some interesting things. Across all four levels, The evidence-based practices that teachers really feel like they're able to implement with fidelity are prompting and modeling were overwhelmingly up there, reinforcement, social narratives, and visual supports. So what I did almost out of the gate was send, we have online, they're called brief packets, but really what they are the research base behind every practice, every evidence-based practice, the step-by-step how-to, and also data collection forms that teachers can use, very friendly format. So even though most of our teachers said they felt like they were using prompting and modeling with fidelity, we sent that out just as a double-check yourself to make sure. Okay, and then here is, and you'll have it in your PowerPoint, we went ahead and gave you where teachers felt like they wanted more training in terms of the evidence-based practice. So we have those, again, broken down into the four. The one, not surprisingly, that came across in all four levels was regarding technology. And so we, again, immediately turned around and sent out all the information about that evidence-based practice to all of our teachers. So then we are using this. Several of these we've already covered in trainings and the upcoming two trainings that I'm doing in October to address this. But in our blueprint, the plan is to, at each one of these levels, provide the trainings for five trainings, the top five evidence-based practices in each one of these levels. And as most of you all know, that's just the tip of the iceberg, because really it becomes into you're trained and now building capacity, and that is also a part of that blueprint plan. And then Diane's going to talk about the parent support.
The second strategy in the blueprint has to do with the family support. As Mr. Caulk was already talking about, that we really need to provide better supports to our families. And so one of the things that we wanted to do up front was not just assuming that we know what our families need, but would be to create a survey. It was a simple survey, just hitting some of the things that we were doing in schools. You know, like, do you feel like you need to know about evidence-based practices or things like that? But just a transition, how to work with schools, just the gamut of things that had been at least said to us, with the opportunity to also tell us, if we didn't ask you, what else do you think that you need? This is the actual survey. The survey is still open. The way we went about distributing the survey is that anyone who had a student with autism in our district who's receiving special education services and who also had an email within our database were sent an introduction plus this survey. I hope that some of you in this room have completed that survey. I recognize some of the names. We want as many people to complete the survey as possible. Other ways that we've distributed this was through email. We've got it listed on our website, so if you go to the Fayette County website, you can also access it there. We have tried to get just the message out any way that we can through stakeholders. We also, through our schools, ask what families might need this in a different language, and how might we provide this to them? Would it need to be an oral translation? Would it need to be a paper translation? So we tried to work with our schools, and I went directly to the schools, knowing that our ACCs in the schools would know the families and who would need this translation. So we've also been translating that and getting that out through our schools. So that's another way that we've tried to access that. To date, we only have 97 responses. So we really want that to increase, and we're hoping to keep that open through the end of the month. But you know, with any survey, a survey is typically not well responded to, but we are trying our best to get this message out. So we would appreciate your help. If you know of anybody who has not filled the survey out, one of the things I talked to Mel about was actually putting it on the ASBG listserv so that it can get out that way. We haven't done that yet, but we wanted to talk to you guys first about this is what it is and this is why we're doing it. So it's really a needs assessment. It's open-ended in many ways so that you can respond how you think you can best provide us that information. Once we get all of the data, then we once again, we're going to have our parents and the people who responded to the survey, our stakeholders, to help us look at the data. We will provide the results, obviously, but then look at that and say, okay, now that we know what our parents are asking us to do, what's the best way to provide this? We've also asked about times, we've asked about sitters and things like that, how we can really make this work and work effectively for parents. So that's kind of where we are with this right now. Yes.
So you will be, you're thinking about you putting it on our listserv.
I'll send it to you to distribute.
Whoever wants to send it. But with 534 students,
yes,
to have 97 families, we want to make sure we get the word out, and we're trying to do the best we can, but again, we can't do it alone, and so we need organizations, we need families to be engaged, to tell us so that we can better serve you.
Because I went there, and if you want me, I mean, but you'll send something that's presentable.
I can send you a narrative if you want to do that, and just send it straight to you.
Sure.
Sometimes I have trouble accessing you through email.
Well,
that's why I
changed
it to
email
Mel.
Addresses, so that's probably the
okay.
Problem.
So I can. I always have Mel, so I can send it to her.
Oh, that's fine. Okay. She's perfect.
Yes.
Send it to Mel.
So that's kind of where we are.
They responded
that's
so far.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. We had questions.
Yes.
Just, are you wanting only parents that have current children in the Fayette County Public School System, or are you wanting the ones that are maybe homeschooling?
No, it's any parent, family, with, and not just parents. If you have other family members, grandparents, you know, because we want to be able to meet their needs too. So anybody within Fayette County who would be participating, you can forward that link to them and have them participate.
I think, sorry, just a couple of things. I'm always ready to jump in to plug. The Autism Support Center is on Fayette County's website. You could just do the search for autism, and it will pop up. On our homepage, there is a link to the parent survey as well.
Yes.
But in an answer to your question, I think that would be wonderful. There is a question on there about if you would be willing to help us plan for those. And I think particularly for our older students in high school, to have the knowledge and experience that you all have had, and now that you are not in schools, I think will be very helpful to our parents with high school students coming up.
Absolutely. So,
yes,
ma'am.
A couple more questions about this, because I know I've gotten like a gazillion reminders about filling these surveys out. So what if you can't remember if you already filled it out? Will it recognize whether you've already submitted one? And then the other question is it one per family or one per child? Because I know on a lot of these that I've gone into, like, for instance, everybody in this room, I'm sure we're all is aware that spectrum is extremely wide.
Yes.
And my children fall on the exact opposite ends of the spectrum from each other. And so on some of those that I've seen, when it asks questions, it would be like, well, it's true for this kid, but it's not true for this kid.
The first part,
go ahead.
I'm just going to jump into the first, which is the latter. But the first, because it's anonymous, there isn't no backup system technology guys who are saying, we recognize your IP address. No. So, you know, it's more the, we want to, it's, so, you know, conceivably a person could fill out 10 of them. You know, we know that, you know, this is a community that we know is built on strong faith and we and trust. So we know that those who will fill it out with that intent. Now, I'll let you answer
but
the
latter part. I was just going to say, you know.
About the students, each job.
Exactly. I mean, really, we're it's not about the student, that what you as a parent or a family. So what are your needs? If you have students across the spectrum, absolutely. What are your needs? And being able to parent that child or access services within the community, we just need to know what that looks like for you. Sometimes mom and dad had different needs. So if mom wants to do it, dad wants to do it, grandparents want to do it, that's great.
Yeah, about my own family. Yeah,
there's a section. There's a section for comments where you can also say, I'm so-and-so, and I would like to participate in developing a group or something for families. So, you know, just any, we would just want to be able to meet your needs.
I was just going to say, too, you may be referring to some of the other surveys you're receiving.
I've gotten
it. Because we have a, we also did a special education survey last year, actually about three. But two were required by the Department of Education, and the other one was the one that we developed specifically for Fayette County. And in that case, you answered everything for your first child, and then you could click a button, and it would say, now answer these for your other child and the experiences you've had at that school or in that classroom. So that may be what you were thinking.
Yeah, I know. I've just gotten a ton of them, and on a couple of them, it was like, the way the questions were worded, I was like, well, it's this kid, but this one is like the total opposite.
So. Yeah, this email should have come with a narrative from me and just inviting you to participate in this survey. So.
And so we want to be cognizant of, and you just touched on it, like survey fatigue, right? And, you know, I mean, I where is that? I might have been at Dairy Queen. You thought survey, and I'm like, oh yes, but then if I can't really get at it, okay, forget that one. But you know, so we want to be cognizant of that and do our best. And I think the best way we can show you is by taking action, that we're listening to those surveys. So again, with the data and the superintendent's plan, it's because we were listening to not only the quantitative data, but the qualitative data that came out through those surveys and focus groups. And so we again, we want to check in and see what your needs are. And so please sort of bear with us. You know, we try not to inundate you this fiscal year with a whole bunch of surveys.
So
you got that.
Okay, so thinking about for all students with exceptionalities, how are we going to close the achievement gap? One of the topics that we talk about very often is ensuring that all students have access to a guaranteed and viable curriculum. And in order to do that for special education students, we wanted a tremendous emphasis on co-teaching for gap closure. And so we have a four-year implementation plan because you have to have the capacity to support the coaching and the professional learning that needs to happen for teaching teams and for their coaches at the building level to make sure that you can have this be successful across the district. So as you can see here with our four-year plan, we use data, we triangulated data by looking at what were the number of students in a school that that received the majority of their services from special education in the general education classroom. And so that was our first data point. And then we also looked at master schedule readiness. Co-teaching takes a lot of planning on the front end to make sure that you're setting it up for success, to make sure that the general ed and special ed teacher have common, devoted, absolute, not negotiable planning time that they must have together in order to plan that instruction. And so we looked at master schedule readiness, and then we just looked at school readiness in general, meaning had teachers and or administrators already sought professional learning around co-teaching from us or from other sources in order to implement. So we wanted people that were already showing an interest and already working toward that, had the numbers of students that needed the service, and then also had their master schedule in a readiness state. And from that, these schools emerged as the first year cohort. And we didn't want to cover a ton of slides, but we have pictures from the training that's been going on, the professional learning opportunities with school teams, where you have at the elementary level a general ed and a special ed teacher, an internal coach, which is generally their PGES coach or associate principals, and then also we have external coaches that will be supporting them. And part of this, the principals are also required to attend as well, so that they understand what's going to be expected of the teams and the support that's being provided. So within co-teaching for gap closure, you have those four areas around it. The professional learning for them has to start first. And then internal coaching at the building level, external coaching from people at the district level, and even some from our Central Kentucky Education Co-op. And then we'll also be doing fidelity checks, where we go in, and it's really more than a walkthrough. It is, we will be there for the entire lesson, and then meet with them to debrief and say what went well, you know, why did you choose that co-teaching model, and, you know, what is your data telling you? And so we really want that to be kind of that continuous loop of they're getting professional learning, they're getting the coaching, and they're having the fidelity checks and feedback.
For Amanda shares with you the next slide, I would just say that I want to thank you because of the input that you shared in the entry plan, superintendent's plan. We were able to hire more special education teachers. Right? And what I mean by that, that's above and beyond. Right? This wasn't what schools get based on their school formula, or what we distribute based on our formula. This was above and beyond. And we did that for special ed, for ELL, and for gifted and talented. And so that four-year implementation plan, you don't see all 67 schools and programs listed. We're going to need your support and support the board as we go over the next 4 years with our strategic plan to hold us accountable to making sure that we add those special education teachers across all schools over the next 4 years. We can't do it all at once.
Why?
Thank you. Thank you, right?
Actually, how do you justify not doing it?
Okay, here you go. If we were to do it all at once, the aggregate tax increase that you get in Fayette County before it gets recalled, or 4%, it would exceed that. I mean, this is the wealthiest, most neediest district I've ever been a part of. And so, unless the employees and great staff at Fayette County want to go without a pay increase for several years, we can't do it all at once either, right? I mean, we got great staff. And
I'm not sure that that's a fair trade-off.
Well, it's not about the trade-off. It's about making sure two things, right?
I think you'll have a better chance getting the money for raises if you spend the money on the teachers. If you spend the money on the teachers, you come up with a deficit. I cannot give my teachers raises, and they'll give it to you.
I've been in other communities. I'm not so sure. I'm looking around the room over here and over here. But it's two things, though, right? It's two things. One, we want to make sure that we continue to value all of our employees, right? And at the same time, we want to make sure that we invest in our children. And so that's what we're trying to do, and they're at that balance. So that's why we didn't do it all at once for special education teachers, for ELL, for gifted and talented. You know, the prudent, even though it's a pace, but to be thoughtful. What I need from you is that every year, every fiscal year, what about that investment for our students? To make sure it gets across, right? To hold us accountable, because tough decisions. If you ask, you want to see the trend line, I always had that slide. I can show you our pay increases since the Great Recession, right? This year, we only gave step increase. Only 93% of employees walked home with more pay. 7% did not, right? And I can look right over here. You want me to hold the line on that every, right?
We've already taken it.
I know, right? Exactly. So for our staff, all our employees, we want to continue to, at the same time we value them, we want to do that, we want to continue to invest in our students. I think that's a more prudent way without shifting a higher burden onto our taxpayers. Does that make sort of sense? So it's
I think you need to bring it all back to accountability.
Yes.
I think that's really what you mean.
Yes.
And really what you say is, I'm a product of Fayette County Public Schools. I taught in Fayette County Schools at one time. I have three kids in Fayette County Public Schools. And they're in three different schools. And they might as well be in three different states.
Yes, that's right.
Because every school is completely different.
Yes.
This kid gets this kid. And that is my number, if I could sit down with you, that's my number one issue. Because it's not right. It's not right that at Garrett Morgan, that principal is in the classroom every single day. She's constantly there. She's the first smiling face you see in the morning. Those teachers know 100% what's expected of them. You go to a different school, I won't name names, we've got kids all over the county.
I appreciate it.
And the teachers are doing whatever they want. I'm in the school, I'm in the PTA. They're on their cell phones, they're sitting at their computers, they're hanging out in the hallway, their husbands are there for lunch. We've got to have accountability from the top.
Yes.
To where you say, I want to know what you're doing as a principal, and I want to know what these teachers are doing, and special ed departments from school to school.
Exactly.
And when do we fire the principal?
It shouldn't have been.
You know,
my child is not supposed to be in Garrett Morgan. My school was overcrowded, so we were fortunate enough to get to go there, and we jumped for joy because we were scared to death for our kid to go where he was districted for. So we just can't have that. I don't know if it's the school-based decision-making councils. It's not, you know, this school gets this and this school gets that, and we're sitting here going, this is not fair. These kids are so much on free and reduced lunch, and these kids don't have these programs, but these few people are getting to make the decisions for everything, yet we don't have school choice.
So here's my challenge. That's a great point. And here's my challenge to you, because I didn't come here just to talk at you, right? I came because we need your help, and I want to challenge you at your schools to, you saw on that slide one of the emerging themes was school-based decision-making councils. It was a theme not because the people thought highly of it. It was a theme for some of the reasons you said. And I'm not here to kind of go either way. I just say, as a parent asked me at Bryan Station High School, going to town hall, a listening session, I said, you know, my view on them, they work where they work and they don't where they don't. I said that then, I'll say it again, and it's on camera. What I need, because I don't think it represents the student population in the building, and I've seen the makeup, I need you to get active and to run for whatever your SBDM and be that voice.
Melanie tried that.
Okay,
yeah,
oh,
it
okay.
It was lonely.
Okay.
It is.
But we have to. I mean, I know it's kind of like, it's not, for me, I was just with the commissioner this today and others, it's not sort of shifting burden, but that's the current system that's been in place since the 90s, right? I mean, it has been, the careful, since the 90s. And so, as we're 3 months into building shared accountability, which we're doing, and adding additional resources, skilling them up and everything, it's not going to change over 3 months into it because something that's been going on for that long, right? And trying to change behavior, trying to change culture. But I also need the community and individuals who are passionate about not only their child, but all children, and can be the voice for the voiceless, and for those who are disenfranchised, to come into those SBDM roles and serve, you know, and begin to make a difference. I mean, I went to one SBDM and looked around the table, and I looked out the door and said, more people coming? It's like, no, this is it. I said, this isn't even like a student population. It doesn't look nothing like the students that you're making decisions for. You know, and so when I spoke to my students at the high school, you know, I didn't let the schools sort of pick, cherry pick. I said, I want a representation of your demographic. Race, language, those in ELL, right, receiving supports and services, students with exceptionalities, everyone at the table. Because I want to hear from all students. And it was just me, the students, and that's why the guidance counselor that you talked about came up. There's some other issues. But, you know, want to make sure that it's the representation of our, of the school, of our district. That's why I searched that video. Right, to kind of ground it for you, that this is how we look, which looks a lot different than the county. Starkly different.
Hey, I'm wondering my parent had to make it.
Please.
Just making sure you are aware of which hat I'm
wearing.
That's fine. William has been in the school system since first grade.
Okay.
We made the personal choice after our experience with the Head Start program in the county to put him in a Montessori program instead.
Love Montessori.
What we found with William is that if there is a crack, he falls through it. And if I did not have the central office connections that I do, if I did not have the parent voice that I do, if I did not have the big fat mouth that I have because I grew up in Massachusetts and don't mind telling people, you know, he would fall through the cracks.
Exactly.
We have, and Tanya knows this, we go rounds, meeting, trying to figure out, because there is no box to check William, and that is one of the big things that comes with autism.
Yes.
There is no box to check for autism, and our kids need, while they don't necessarily need the academic support, they definitely need extra adult support in the classroom, instructional aids, so that the teachers are not having to constantly remind the same kid over and over again to sit in a chair, stop wiggling, because that the classroom teacher has to teach every other kid.
That's right.
And there are times that I feel that my kid sucks the attention from other students, and there are times that I feel like he sometimes misses the attention he's supposed to have. And I know that all things considered, how many are he
was. Yeah. And we
need to address some of those issues, especially dealing with our students with autism.
That's right. And what we want for your child, right, is for every child. Just think about a child whose parent isn't in the system, who doesn't have that voice, a parent whose first language other than English, right? And so to me, that's the equity piece that came up, you know? And so we want to make sure that we don't just respond to selective parents, but we do what's right for all children, right? And like I said, we're 3 months into it, and we know we got a long way to go. We didn't get here overnight. You know, I can tell you number one strategy that Fayette County used to increase student outcomes and close the opportunity gap for a decade. And that strategy has, while you're here, because you know the strategy hasn't worked. But they used it repeatedly, year after year after year after year, and it just didn't work. This is the first time, only 3 months into it, to doing something differently. And because of, now, beginning of the Great Recession, 2008, that video would look a lot different, right? Today is where we're at, and we can't do it alone. We need you. We need you, again, to be the voice for those who are voiceless as well, to get involved in governance at the school level, to hold us, governance at the district level, accountable for continuing adding the resources, right? The resource and the professional learning. And the family engagement to make sure that we're meeting and trying to get it right and continuously trying to get it right. I look at a model called continuous improvement. Just trying to be better than you were before, right? Just intensely to improve and be willing to have the tough conversations, right? Last century, we didn't have conversations because they would identify problems. But no one wanted to feel like they were identifying problems, so you kind of shy away from the conversation. This center, I believe we need conversations to solve problems. So you want to engage in conversation. Now, if you do this, I don't want to deal with sort of individual students in school. This is, you know, I got 6,800 employees and staff, right? But just using an example and then kind of broadly so that we can get feedback so that we can better serve our students and families. Yes, ma'am.
So are those the most gapped schools on that list? How is that list
chosen? Oh, great question. Yes, thank you.
That's what I was talking about when I said the way that we looked at the data was the largest number of students that required their special ed services be provided in the general education classroom. Also, the school's master schedule readiness and the school readiness as far as their where they were in their professional learning already. So
and that's
we looked
how you
at
chose
that's
that
how
group
those
of schools.
Yes. Yes, that is how those schools were chosen.
And you can see feeder patterns emerge.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You can just see the feeder pattern. Mm-hmm. So it's not just the school, it's like the community, that community mm-hmm. that the school is nestled in all the way through.
Superintendent Caulk mentioned continuous classroom or continuous improvement. And within the professional learning that's happening for our teams that are coming to the co-teaching training, we are really focusing on a systems approach to classroom instruction, and it is called continuous classroom improvement. It's all about having those teacher-student partnerships where you create a class mission with your class. You involve the students in what are our learning goals, making sure they know what they are and know what's expected for them and how they're going to get there. And in the process, they even identify these are our struggles. Like, these are the things that are going to make it harder for us. And so what are we going to do? They have a little ladder diagram with this is our current as-is state. This is where we want to be. How are we going to get there? And you really involve the students in that process. And there's such an important focus on the planning process with the two teachers together, making sure that, if you look there, the student supports. When you think about the evidence-based practices and the visual supports and everything that any student with an exceptionality may need in that co-taught classroom, there's a big focus on how do we make sure those student supports are there. Yes, ma'am.
Sorry. I've been sitting there thinking, like, I'll just wait for the right time to
no,
say
jump
this,
in.
And this is
now
the perfect time. I work for an outside company. We provide ABA therapy for children with autism and other developmental disabilities. And we would love to be student supports, but what we have found is that there is not a consistency among the schools. We have 3 or 4 schools in Fayette County that will let us in to observe our clients, to like see what's going on in the classroom, offer suggestions and mm-hmm. strategies. We have 1 school that's told us we have to get a permission slip from every parent of a child that's in here. We have 1 school that told us mm-hmm. that going into the schools is illegal and what we're doing is breaking the law.
Okay.
Every person. Every school has a different answer. And so the schools that we're in like really appreciate us and value us, and you know, I feel like I'm really helping. They can provide better therapy outside of the school and a better full picture of what that child goes through mm-hmm. and what that family needs. And then the other schools, it's kind of this question mark where we can't get emails back from teachers, like we can't even get anyone to talk to us.
This is my kid.
Yeah, no, okay, I don't want to say that.
It's all of our kids.
Please continue. I'm sorry, I got excited.
Here we are, like, desperately trying to help, and we can't even get, like, a general education or special education teacher to respond to an email.
I can speak to that a little, and then others can chime in if they would like. There is a board policy related to visitors in the school that really does put that squarely in the hands of the school level to make decisions about visitors in the school. That's a board policy, and it's the Kentucky School Boards Association recommended policy. About visitors in the school. And so each school has their own.
Can you say maybe visitors in the school? That's not what
I'm saying. I'm sorry.
I have read that policy. And it does not prohibit.
There you go.
It does not prohibit it. But, so I guess what we would want from you as a superintendent is to be clear with your principals, collaborate and cooperate with these people who are trying to help.
Yes. Well, 2 things. I agree with that part. I think before that is clarification of the policy itself. Mm-hmm. As well, because you want to, so what happens for those sort of policy locks that kind of mm-hmm. districts in Kentucky, not just Fayette County, KSBA, Kentucky School Board Association, comes up with sort of these model policies, and then they adopt those policies, right? And so we do policy review, but you don't know if it's coming in conflict with your value until you have a discussion such as this, that somehow that policy that's designed, right, to prevent something is now excluding something that you want. And then you have schools with their own sort of, and that doesn't work, because what we need to do then is look at that policy, have it revisited with Shelley, with Katrina, and see if we can. So this is, it's really good time. I'm glad we had this conversation. I would never have thought that was the, again, I learned.
We've had that issue as well. I don't know if anybody else here.
It's everywhere.
Why can a parent come into a classroom I read with the kids, I do reading groups in my regular kids' classrooms, but
I was made to feel like I was not allowed in the special education classroom.
Okay. So let me go to your point with the policy. Real quick, because part of the plan and the superintendent's plan is to do the strategic plan for the district, and we're going to we're actually on time to probably have a white paper, sort of the strategic plan just in text, not all glossy and all, right, probably by the end of October, beginning of November. Right behind that is a review of all of our policies to make sure that they're consistent with the equity and what we seek to achieve going forward. So I want to make sure that we capture this particular policy in that review so that we can look and see what we can do, because that's exactly what we want. What I want, I just say me. I just say very much. That's what I want. I want you to go in and help us. And if it's, you know, whatever you got to do within the confines of the policy, because we have to protect other children, you know, in the classroom, etc. But I want to be able to see how we can remove those barriers and create a policy that allows for you to do your job in support of our families as well.
Especially since you all were talking about evidence-based practices, and that's what we do, you know? Like, we're all trained in that, and I'm sure, like, speak for my coworkers, if, you know, you wanted us to complete an additional, like, Fayette County Public School, like, student privacy sensitivity training, like, send us some modules online, we'll fill them out, like, because we passionately want to help our students and our clients.
And I want you in every school that you have a student that you're serving as well.
Instead of just three or four, which some of the ones that we're in were on your list for cohort one, so that's exciting.
But we want, so those are the big issues that we can tackle and wrestle with at the board level. In order to get, and that way we get uniform compliance and standardization across schools.
That's exactly my point. Not only standardization across the schools, but classrooms have a structure and a culture and a tone. People walking in and out of the classroom could send some of our kids ballistic, which disrupts the entirety. So you're going to have a system, a sequence, and a standardized way of doing it every time.
Yes.
So you're getting the best value for what you're offering and not the standard.
That's a great thing.
I would just like to segue into what you said, Hazel. Kind of give you a little bit of a picture. Everything that you saw up here that we're doing in terms of training for evidence-based practices, surveys, the website, the autism website that we created, the classroom resource guide that we created to provide, that was really before our schools were fully embracing the Charlotte Danielson framework for teaching. And so there wasn't anything out there. So we developed that to try to help our schools with that uniformity. All of these things are really almost like my second job. I will tell you that since school started, I've worked with 41 different teachers in Fayette County Schools, and 90% of those have been at the elementary level. in terms of standard procedures, I think you're spot on. And what I would recommend that you do, which we've done with a couple of other agencies, is that you contact me and let me come and meet with your entire team and let's talk about our roles and responsibilities and how that works. Because and for a couple of reasons. First and foremost, to know me is to know that I love your children with autism. And I think the history of being here, and I feel like being one of the strongest advocates for students with autism, one of the things that we see now, unfortunately, not everyone who comes into our schools who says I'm a behavior therapist or I do this or I do that, does not come with those credentials that you're here with tonight. And there may, and we have had situations where people are coming in and they are recommending things that are not evidence-based practices, and they're coming into our schools with really very little expertise in that area of autism. So I think over the years I've become, and everyone can, I'm protective of these kids in our district, and I'm particular about who we want to make sure that the people that we're working with, A, that it's a partnership. The first thing that I would say to your agency and the other agencies that we've talked to, when your parents come to you and they say, I am not happy with what's happening at school, call me, call Diane, call Amy, and let us know. And if we're not involved, we'll certainly become involved to help that. And then to make sure that those wraparound services and that you're supporting us at school and that we're supporting you at home as well.
That's the key. I think it's not that we're not necessarily happy, and I'm going to come across that way at all. It's that, just like she said, none of our kids check a box.
Yeah.
It's a different formula for each child. Yeah. And Fayette County will provide occupational therapy to my child, and that occupational therapist can get in and talk to anybody and be on the same page and speech. And like, when are we going to get to the point that we say this is an evidence-based practice? Mm-hmm. Autistic children need behavior support. Mm-hmm. Either Fayette County needs to provide that, or we need to let it. We need to get out. So that's my point. And I don't want anybody in there that's not certified.
Right.
But when you've got people coming that say, I do have these certifications, I do want to help.
Yeah.
It saves me a lot of time from every time I pick him up, okay, well, this is what he's doing in therapy, and then I go to therapy, and we spend 15 minutes. Well, this is what they're doing in school.
Right.
It's a lot of learning time that's missed.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Where the parent has to do
right.
So I just don't want you to... It's
no,
not
no. And
stones.
I think
it's,
just over...
It's got to be...
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Everybody's got to be on the same page.
I agree
100%. Everybody's got to be working
100%.
For the same goal.
And we have those relationships because there is a practice in town that... We just have a long-standing relationship with, and so we have that standardized system with, and so I would encourage your company to contact us so that we can meet and set those same things up, you know, so that we know who's supporting who and how we can do that even better.
Yes, ma'am.
And this is, I want to follow up on what they're talking about because I have a daughter who's 24 who has autism, but I have a son who's 18 and is also on the spectrum. And so the thing that she's bringing up, it has been a long term, has happened many, many, many times in my, you know, Amelia started going to public school when she was 3. So the many years that I've had relationships with Bay County, and the policy says the visits must be reasonable in length and frequency and related to the needs of the child. So, I mean, believe me, I have read that policy. That's why I've read that policy 50,000 times. And so any building level administrator should be able to say, does this person who has credentials and who works outside of the school with the student, is this related to the needs of the child? Absolutely it is. Well, you know, but unfortunately, and from what Hazel said, unfortunately, many times what you might run into is someone who's, for whatever reason, wants to keep you like this.
The fortress.
Yes.
The fortress.
So, I don't know how you...
Years, you can't cross it.
Yes. I don't know. You can't leave the office sometimes, so that's the moat. But So how would the board create an example framework of what to do when, like a process that should be followed to make that work and flow properly?
So I think it's exactly what you just described, is the inconsistency, school to school, right, varies. So what a board does is establish policy. Under that, we create the procedures, right? Then you train up the people so that the practice is consistent. And you lead to a uniform sort of product. In this case, it would be implementing policy that folks who should come in, they can meet the needs of the child, and those who, you know, help, whatever that looks like, right, are excluded, if you will. And so that's the time for us to go back and kind of look at our policy. The policy's clear, it allows for that, and we got a policy that says, and I'm just, and I don't know, but a policy, let's just say, arguendo, that the policy says, yes, it's permissive, but the practice is the fortress itself. Then that's the people, right? Training up the people. And so that's what determines whether or not it's the policy, whether or not it's the people, whether or not it's the practice.
And the consistency.
That's what did it. That's the practice.
I think that's the biggest frustration. It's the biggest frustration.
And that's the practice. And some of that, is in this case, is the policy we're talking about here, it's sort of the board policy. And the other are what's in the purview of the SBDM. Yes, ma'am.
You had mentioned this is a very wealthy county.
It is. So let me qualify that, right? What I said. you got it on tape, so we know this is what I said. This is the wealthiest, most neediest district that I ever been in. I've been in Chicago. They just, you know, and I've been in Philadelphia, so I haven't been in any place that had the wealth and need. It was all just needy, right? But don't have the wealth in the need. For example, you got state-of-the-art buildings. Those buildings are beautiful, right? But that's not where the magic happens. You got state-of-the-art buildings, and on the inside, I just shift from special ed to ELL. You got teachers with a caseload of 1 to 90. Right? You don't have a GT teacher in every building. But you got great looking buildings. Drive by, they look awesome. Right? So to me, the investment should be what goes on the inside. And that's what we're doing differently. Right? And that's why we broke with the strategy that we've been using for a decade. And it's tough because I got some flag, I got arrows in my back because I'm saying we want the same old strategy that hasn't worked. But we still want that strategy. Yes, ma'am.
And that's where my question goes to, is the allocation of funds, and how do we get more very able-bodied
responsibility for teachers has gone way up in the past 20 years. We used to have a cap on caseload of 8 students, it's 8 special ed students per teacher. Responsibility creep has been almost impossible to keep up with.
But you look at, again, to my point, is that when I look at the wealth in this county, and I see the school buildings, yet you see, just as Susan said, the cap, like it creeped up for over a decade. It's been, instead of someone saying we need to do something different about how we allocate resources, because they're scarce. My background is special education, you know, and when it came to my child, as I told you at the outset or the intro, I voted with my feet. I moved, right? But then I also got my degree in special education so that I can help other people's children. And I was a co-teacher and, you know, made all the difference. And so that's my own sort of journey in order to meet the needs of my child and help other people's children. What we're doing now is a paradigm shift by adding more resources. And it's going to take, you know, because we didn't get it overnight, that's why I said over 4 years, and we're going to need you to hold us, our feet to the fire. right? And the board to say, this is what we're gonna do for children. We still gotta value our employees, but we got to continue to invest so they don't have the caseloads. And they saw that, that was one emergent themes. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, with beautiful buildings, you should have, you know, sort of best practice and reasonable caseloads because your buildings are great. Yes, ma'am.
This kind of goes along with it. It's, I have two middle school kids and they both have IEP. So they're not autistic, but they are ADHD. I call my kids the alphabet too. But, so with the co-teaching, and I know that's I'm in one of the schools that y'all are trying to work on. And I have one kid who's in co-teach, and I have one kid who's in collaborate, because she spends a lot of her time in general ed, or special ed, her collaborative special ed. But the collaborative class size is huge, and the percentage of kids who have IEPs in there, one of them is 68%. So I went to an ARC earlier this year and had someone from district there, and they said, let's figure out a way to help her, and it's, and the teacher sat there and said, I have 20 kids with IEP. I cannot do what you're asking me to do. And then KDE actually recommends 33% or less. So but we're sitting a child in the 68%. The school is like, we want to help you, but we can't make it low. She does not want to go to school every single day. Every single day I have to drive her to school. Every single day I have to stay there. And that does not help when I have to be at an elementary school to help with my little boys too. Like, I'm only one person. And so what are you going to do towards that? Because collaborative, co-teach is really split off. A para-educator is not allowed to instruct my child legally. I'm like, so right. She can't be pulled away. You can't take. There's 20 kids in one class with an IEP, and then there was five kids who had a positive. Out of 38 kids.
You're right. I mean, you see the shifting demographics. You see the fact that, as I said, it ties right to your point. The wealth, yet the need has increased. And because I can't reverse a decade of a bad strategy in 3 months,
and
I ain't going to, you know, it's about waiting for Superman. Superman's not coming through the door. But the super friends are here, and that's you too. And that's what I mean, we gotta make sure that we do that and do it consistently to make sure that we don't have this disproportionality, this sort of disparity there, right?
I was just gonna say, the point that you make is why that master schedule readiness is so important, because I think what schools have, with good intention, done is by placing not every student in that class needed to be in that collab class necessarily, or in that co-talk class. But by nature of how they did their schedule, several kids ended up in there that isn't a service on their IEP, but it's a student with an IEP who happens to be in that room, and it really inflates the numbers of kids that are identified with some type of exceptionality that are in that classroom. So that's why working with the schools on master scheduling is so important, so that you, on the front end, plan for, I'm not saying we don't need more teachers, let me be clear.
We do need more teachers, being clear with that. Yeah. And the fair statement, you know, illustrates that. But I think your point too is that, again, I think you touched on it, right? Capital A, accountability. Make sure they do everything they do in terms of programming and their schedule for our students as well. And so, you know, both need to occur.
I'm sorry, I want to bounce back to that idea, Amanda, that you brought up with the scheduling, because at the high school level, what your fear is as a parent is that my child's not going to be filtered through a specific schedule based on the fact that we only have staffing for certain classes. And so you look at the school and you say, wow, there's all these opportunities, but in reality, there's not all those opportunities for my student because they can only be in co-teach classes. And so you see students, their opportunities in life
deteriorate because, you know, this child likes Legos, he wants to do the CAD class, but the CAD teacher doesn't have a co-teacher in there with him because it's an elective versus, you know, a core curriculum class, so then that student doesn't get the opportunity to take that class.
That's right.
And that's what I don't want to see happen for all these brilliant children with ASD.
Amen. And you're absolutely correct, right? And that's one of the things we got to achieve is the opportunity and access. That's what we're trying to do. But, you know, so we need you to help us hold our feet to the fire to make sure we continue to make that investment. Because it's easy to walk away from that investment. I think with the board we got now, because they support it and they understand, right, that that's the investment we need to make is in our students and still value our staff. Because you got to do both. We talked about that previously. And so we've got to make sure we continue to do that because it is all about making sure that students have that opportunity. Right. I know if you weren't anyone with that.
I just wanted to touch on, I'm reluctant to bring this up again, but the comment that was made about the access in a special education classroom by a visitor. Under FERPA, we must have the consent of other parents in that classroom because if you are entering that classroom, all of the students in that room are identified as having a disability. And so we provide them with the consent form and a letter, and we really do that. I mean, we also limit that university observers can't go in unless a parent has consented. I mean, there's multiple layers to that, but we do send a letter when that request happens to say from time to time there may be people who request to have visitors in the classroom, whether it's a parent wanting someone to come in or whether it's a university wanting someone to come in.
I have something to say about that.
Okay.
This year is the first year I've seen that letter.
Well, this is my first year here.
I've never seen it before.
Not really. I was here last year.
It's a letter that says that there might be people coming in and out of the classroom. Would you allow them to come in and out of the classroom? This is the first year I've seen that letter.
Okay. Well, at least we're being consistent on that point.
Yeah.
So we want to go here because I know you've been waiting.
We did send that.
So I wanted
to. I just wanted to ask, does every student who's on the spectrum, the autism spectrum, have an IEP?
No, not necessarily.
No. Does it have to be requested by a parent? Or how do they get that plan?
We have a child find obligation, so if anyone, community member, parent, teacher, any staff member, anyone suspects that a child has a disability and may be in need of special education services, then there's a referral process.
And so, is there a renewal of that plan every year?
Mm-hmm. Yes, annually. And a reevaluation
every three years.
Years.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, but I know you wanted to. Oh, Melanie, wait a minute. How about you?
So, FERPA says that about the special education classroom. What if you want to go into the general
education? That doesn't. That would not apply.
That's
what we need to support.
Yes, then it's because
That's not right. Legally. Applies to any
city
where the child's educational evaluation can be observed or read or examined.
It does apply, but if you go into a general education setting, you are not identifying which children in here have IEPs. When you go into a special education classroom, you're identifying that every student in there does.
Yeah,
FERPA applies to all, yes.
There was a U.S. Supreme Court case where that was about FERPA, and the argument was, does it violate FERPA for students to switch papers and to grade papers and then to call score out? And the Supreme Court said that it was not a violation of FERPA because that FERPA applies to written school records and that the grade that was being called out was not a written school record until it was entered in the grade book. And so that's where I get a frustration. Not that I want to go in anybody's classrooms anymore, but that's where I get frustration, where you have a U.S. Supreme Court ruling that says FERPA applies to written school records, and I'm fine with the signing of the paper, but I think that sometimes parents perceive that as a stumbling block. Instead of saying, let me help you get these papers filled out so that all the parents know that they have a right to privacy and it's their right to waive it or not waive it.
Yeah.
And then, and let me help it, let it work that out. But unfortunately, I don't think that's the way the conversation is conducted.
I think it's the void of a conversation.
Yeah, it's used
I think it's sort of
as a stop sign.
Yeah.
It's
well, we would love to let you, but we'll have to send home this paper and every parent would have to sign it. And so it's like, we'd love to, but yeah, not going to happen.
Whereas,
but people, like, I'm sorry, and
no,
I may just be misunderstanding, Burpa, but parents come into the school.
They do not go into special ed classrooms unless that sign is
okay, but they can go into
unless their child is the only one that's in it.
General education classrooms, or even lunch.
Right.
Like, parents can come and eat lunch with their children, and that is not a violation.
Not a classroom.
Not a, right.
Yeah. And so, could we go to lunch? Could we go to
like,
recess?
That's a struggle.
But they don't bring
the
next.
I think it's the school and the practice is inconsistent across.
And a lot of times when we're there, we're not trying to be like, hey, everybody, we're here for this kid in the back of the room. Like, we have to just, you know, like, we're willing to go and, like, stand in the hallway and look inside and be like, okay, like, he's smacking every other child in here, or he sits beautifully in his chair and is, like, looking at the teacher when she talks. All right, I guess, you know, they don't need any help here, or, like, a lot of times just, we just want to observe.
Collecting data.
And, yeah, collect some data. And it's still like, a lot of times it just feels like we're running into walls.
But me, as a parent and an administrator and educator, I want to know who's in the hallway looking at kids, what time they're coming, what's their qualification for being there, and that I have consented to them being there at that time.
You're correct.
So that's all that I'm saying.
And the point that Tanya made earlier about really wanting to partner so that we all establish our roles, we have the obligation to provide the IEP services. So we always have to balance, if you are there observing, you are not necessarily the one providing the service at that time. That's our responsibility. So that's all that, you know, we need to clarify as far as if that's going on and in the schools where you are coming in. That's our obligation, that we provide the IEP services. But we want to work with as many qualified, licensed,
qualified,
certified, you know,
so we got
providers for rapid.
We got 1, 2, 3 questions in the back, and then speaking of our children, I got to go do my chemistry homework. But I listened to the 3 questions, and then I got a general statement to make about another piece we need you. I say, I need you. Yes.
I'm just going to give you a general statement. I'm serving on a subcommittee for the autism in the state, and it's a school age committee. And I want to give you just, I can't say a whole lot about it, but I will say that we're going in the direction of getting ABA, I think. I think they, you know, it's in discussion, and I think that we are going to make progress towards that area.
Yes.
I think, you know, it's in discussion. So there is hope.
Well, let me know if you need a superintendent or you need me to share something with the commissioner, etc. They kind of.
Well, I just.
So just whenever you need me to get engaged or.
I'd like to have your input.
Yes.
So that I can take it back to the committee.
Exactly. Yes, ma'am.
My question, I don't understand. I might be mistaken. So. A lot of our schools are asking for parent volunteers to come in and read with students and do X, this, Y, Z. A lot of our schools, and I'm telling you, I have 3 different middle school, high school, and elementary, and they're doing this. They are doing it with special education kids because that's where the huge gap is. So if you're saying, I'm telling you, I've never signed a paper so anybody can come to my kid. I have 4, you know, that are to be under that. So how is parent volunteers doing it if you're saying they're not allowed? And I can tell you, I mean, I won't tell you because I don't want them to get in trouble. But I can tell you schools are doing it.
Yeah.
Because that is where our gap is. That is, I mean, that's not only, that's not the only part, but that's a big thing.
Well, if a volunteer is assigned to work with a student or a small group of students, I can't speak to that because I don't know the specific situation. They may be meeting in the library with a group of students, and I would hope that they are not revealing any confidential information about that child,
other than this is, you know, what they you need to be working on with them if you're a volunteer. But that is why the principal has to manage ultimately who the volunteers are and what needs to be provided, because they've got to make sure that those protections are in place as well. So I don't know if they're going into the classroom or to the library or some other setting. I really don't know the specifics.
Sounds inconsistent. I think it's your point. Yes, ma'am. And then, yeah, you were
I did, but it was just a general. One of my questions was when, because I knew that we had to sign the forms and all that and get permission. When someone is asking for permission to go into the special ed classroom, and that note letter goes home to all the parents, is it saying that? Is it giving specifics about that student, or what is what exactly is that letter asking for?
I could. I mean, most of you, some of you have seen it. It says a very general. From time to time, we have requests for visitors to enter the special education classrooms for either to observe as a university student, to you know, a parent may be wanting to observe, or a parent may have a provider they are wanting to observe. So it does not give specifics as to for this child or
what
provider.
Are getting
no,
and all that.
No, not at all.
Could we make it specific? Like maybe not. No. Like well, maybe not like why we're going in, but maybe just more like. These are the credentials that this person has. Okay. It's,
you mean from the person going
yeah,
in?
Like, yeah, not on the child.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, not on the child, or not even why I'm going in, but just like, not instead of a visitor is requesting to come in, but like someone that has, you know, is enrolled in a master's program, has 2 years of experience, has this certification, like works with, you know, various clients, like they would like to come in.
We can look at that, but we tried to make it more broad because once you got consent, you had consent for whatever the situation was. So we can consider that. But
yes, ma'am.
I'm just reading from Wright's Law.
Yes.
Confidentiality.
It's been a long time. Used to be an attorney. I'm a recovery. I know. That's you said Wright's Law. She knows.
I'm reading from Wright's Law.
Yes. Or Black Law, right?
W-R-I-G-H-T.
Yes.
The confidentiality requirements in the Family Education Rights and Privacy Act, FERPA, relate to education records and do not prohibit parental observations in the classroom. Hmm. So I don't know that you need to get anybody's permission. I don't think that you need to be prohibiting parents from being in there. The Individuals with Disabilities Act of 1997-2004 emphasized strengthening the parental role and expanding the rights of parents to be active participants in decisions about their child's educational programs and placements. And finally, although IDEA does not include a specific right to a parent to observe their child's classroom or proposed placement, the U.S. Department of Education encourages school district personnel and parents to work together in ways that meet the needs of both, including opportunities for parents to observe their children's classrooms and propose placement options. Mm-hmm. So I think this is an issue that should not be an issue.
I can tell you at the state level we get conflicting information about that. So
I'm really glad you read that and it's on the camera.
Yes. So what I want to do is two things in closing. First, I want to thank you for giving up your time to be here this evening and to help us better serve you. Please, if you haven't, complete the survey, spread the word. We're going to send it out to Melanie so you can distribute, right? And tell, you know, tell others so that we can get the feedback, because we're going to act on that data. We would hate to act on data that's from a small sample, but we're going to act anyway, right? And so, you know, we want to make sure we get the word out. The other piece is that for the first time ever in winter, spring, we're going to do surveys, family surveys across all our schools, anonymous surveys, so that you can give feedback about your school, much broader than sort of some of the issues we're talking about, but just as you said, is it a fortress school, etc., because we want to get better, and then that helps us with accountability. So that now that I got data from, because we do a couple pieces of data. We get our TEL survey data, which is from our teachers, right? And they're a great part of the equation, not the only part. They contribute to student success. We have staff in the building. So for the first time ever, we're going to do surveys of our staff so they can have input to that culture and that environment in the school. And then the most important piece of that equation are you, our families. So first time ever, you'll be to give input in terms of what's going on in that school for each school that your child attends. And the expectations, principals would triangulate that data. At the high school, the students will also be able to give input and complete a survey. So I really want you, as we get to that time, to disseminate and make sure. And then lastly, get engaged at the local school governance level, SBDMs, right? Be that voice, not only for your child, but for other people's children. So thank you, thank you, thank you. I gotta go do my job. Thank you, Steve.